sessions all tie in. I hope you begin to see a pattern. I hope some of the pieces of the puzzle start falling in place for you, that God has two distinct plans and purposes that he has been carrying on through the ages. And this is a verse we looked at. I can't stress too much this verse, so I wrote it down for us. I thought, well, I finished a little ahead of some of you, and I'll write it down. Jesus Christ, look at the next word, was. Okay? Jesus Christ is not now a minister of the circumcision. In fact, he called Paul and gave a brand new message. Now Jesus Christ is ministering to all the nations. But in the past, he was, and that's in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he was a minister. He taught. But he was a minister of the circumcision. That's not you and me. For the truth of God, to confirm the promises made to the fathers. Now, this is not like vague. This is not like, you know, we don't read that and say, oh, I have no idea what he taught then. Sure, we can know what he taught. All we have to do is find out what God promised the fathers of Israel in the Old Testament. That's all we got to do. And then we'll know Jesus Christ was teaching that. He was confirming that. And that's what we're going to do in this session. We're going to take a quick look at the covenants that God made with Israel. Now, I'm going to tell you this right up front, so we can be real plain and clear about it, is we are, I could almost say were, because now, as believers, we're members of the body of Christ. But we're members of the nations, not the nation Israel. And all the covenants God made, he made with the nation Israel. He didn't make any covenants with the Gentiles. He didn't make any covenants with all the rest of the nations. And so you and I are not under any covenant relationship with God. We have some grand things, and in fact, I'm going to have to tell you, we have better things. But at this session, in the next one, we'll get to that. But in this session, it's very important, I believe, that we know what God promised to the fathers. Because if that's what Jesus Christ is ministering, Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises made to the fathers. Now I know, every time Jesus Christ opens his mouth in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he's simply validating the covenants that God made with Israel. So let's look at them. There are three basic covenants that we're going to look at. Go to Romans chapter 9, by the way, and we're going to start there. You say, now, and you know, the funny thing is, every time we learn something about Israel, we go to Paul first, even though he didn't write to Israel. And you know why we do that? Because he explains to us why we're not Israel. He explains to us why what he's teaching is something different. Like, if I want to know what Jesus said in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, I go to Romans chapter 15, verse 8, and I find out Jesus Christ is the minister of the circumcision. You see how that works? And if I want to know what God promised to the fathers of Israel, I go to Romans chapter 9. So you go there. Now, God made three basic covenants with Israel. Whoops. The Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, and the Davidic covenant. I know it sounds bad up front, but none of these have anything to do with you. But that's okay, because God gave you some scriptures that does have something to do with you. But we're going to look at these covenants and see their details. All right, let's first look at Romans chapter 9. And I got to get there. I told you to go. I wasn't near my Bible. I didn't go. Romans chapter 9, verse 4. Maybe verse 3, so we'll make sure we got the context. Paul says, "For I could wish myself accursed for Christ for my brethren, my kinsmen according to the flesh, who are Israelites, to whom pertaineth the adoption, and the glory, and the covenants, and the giving of the law, and the service of God, and the promises. Whose are the fathers, and of whom concerning the flesh Christ came, who is over all, God bless forever. Paul, in one verse, quickly summarizes the history of Israel, the promises made to Israel. He said the Jews are Israelites. They receive the adoption. They have sonship. You read in the Old Testament, God says, you're my sons. He's talking to Israel. They had the glory. They had all the covenants. The Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic, the Davidic covenant. They had the service of God. Over and over in the Old Testament, God says, Jacob, my servant. Israel, my servant. The whole purpose of the nation Israel was that they were to be a servant. We will see what they were supposed to be doing. They had a great ministry. They flubbed it up royally. But God's going to fix all that. But they had the service of God. They had the promises. The fathers belonged to them. Remember we talked about he's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Whoop, that was none of my ancestors. We got left out. Went to ancestry.com. I didn't get in on that deal. But that's okay, because God comes along with a message for us. Thanks be to God for that. But the fathers, they weren't ours. And as whom concerning the flesh Christ came. He was Israel's Messiah. And so this is what we're going to notice as we notice the covenants. Let's go first of all, and we're going to see the... I don't need that. Get that out of my way. We're going to go to Genesis chapter 12 and look at the Abrahamic covenant. The first in the series of covenants that God made with Abraham and his seed that he made with Israel begins in Genesis chapter 12. So we're just going to notice the details. Now this is all in your notes. Of course, I encourage you not to be looking particularly at the notes right now. You'll be able to follow up on all this later as a way to refresh your memory and study deeper. But right now we're just going to try to focus on these scriptures here. But God's plan for the earth was He was going to choose a nation. That nation which He chose was Israel. But to have a nation, you have to have certain things. And there are four things in particular that you need to have a nation. Doesn't matter if it's Israel or the United States or any nation. There are certain things you have to have. First of all, you got to have some people. You can't go to the desert and look out there and say, man, that's a mighty fine nation. You got to have some people. Simple enough, right? Second thing you're going to need if you're going to have a nation is you got to have some land. You got to have some land for the people. You know, you just don't look at a group of people suspended in midair and see a nation. They have boundaries, this geography. You know, we learned that in school. We know where the boundaries are. And by the way, if you never studied the boundaries that God gave to Israel, they're very detailed and specific. And then you're going to need, if you're going to have a nation, you need a law. You need some law. And then fourth of all, you need a government to go with it. You need some rulers. You need some people who are going to administer the law. So you need government. And these four basic things is what you need in place to have a nation. And what you're going to find out in these three covenants, the Abrahamic covenant, the Mosaic covenant, and the Davidic covenant, God covers the people, the land, the law, and the government. Let's start, first of all, with Genesis chapter 12. Once again, I'm behind you. I need to get there. And verse 1. This is the Abrahamic covenant. Under the Abrahamic covenant, we cover two of these. We get the people and the land. All right, Genesis chapter 12, verse 1. And now the Lord had said unto Abram, get thee out of thy country and from thy kindred and thy father's house into a land that I will show thee. And I will make of thee a great nation. That's the purpose. I'm going to make a great nation. So we're going to have some land. Going to build a nation. And I will bless thee, and I will make thy name great, and they shall be a blessing. And I will bless them that bless thee, and curse them that curses thee. And in thee shall all families of the earth be blessed. Now, again, the emphasis of the earth. Now, how many families of the earth be blessed? All families of the earth be blessed. So listen, it's not that God was not concerned about the Gentiles. Let's put them over here. Or that is, all the other nations. It's not that God is not concerned about them. But if you remember, God's given them the service. So, and here's another thing you need to know. Election. Election. People get all worked up about election in the Bible. You're elect, you're chosen. Election always has to do with service. We should already know that. We elect somebody in the United States, well, in theory, to serve, right? Sometimes somewhere we end up serving them. I don't know how that works. But anyway, but there's an election. And God is picking, God is going to create one nation. And he's going to have this nation be his servant to all the rest of the nations. They're going to serve. This is going to be a service nation. Fair enough. By the way, that's the reason we've been called. We've been called members of the body of Christ. It's not because we're like somebody special and we're, but God's calling us to serve the rest, just like Israel's to serve the rest. Okay, so now we got a land, we got a nation. And it's so that all the families of the earth are going to be blessed. Now I have to tell you, Israel did a miserable job at this. They did a miserable job at everything they tried. And that was all in God's plan. God wanted to show that human flesh, that's the story of human history, by the way, is that without God, you can do nothing. Okay? Israel had learned that lesson. We're going to see it. We're going to see it today. We're going to watch it. I'll show you a couple things that maybe you never even thought about Israel. But the history of humanity is a history of the failure of man without God. You know? And we think, you know, we take great pride. I don't know. Some of us do in the United States. You know, oh, it's the greatest nation on earth, you know? And man, have we looked at our history? Wow. I'm not sure if we see greatness. Well, we won't go there. We've done some of the greatest atrocities that any nation's ever done. And I'll venture to say we'll do more. And we'll end up in great failure before it's all said and done, because without God, you have the destiny of failure. And our nation, of course, thumbs their nose at God. But anyway, that's a whole other story. And so Israel becomes a failure in this. So now go to chapter 13. So right there we see that the promise of the Abrahamic covenant is land and a nation. Chapter 13, God expands on it in verse 14. And the Lord God said unto Abraham, after that Lot was departed from him, lift up now thine eyes, and look from the place where thou art, northward and southward and eastward and westward, and all the land which thou seest, to thee will I give it, and to thy seed forever. To thy seed, you and your seed, your offspring are going to get this land. Verse 15, and all the land which thou seest will to thee will I give it, to thy seed after thee. And verse 16, and I will make thy seed as the dust of the earth, and so that no man can number them. Anyway, so again, the issue is land. Except now, when he was back in his home country, God just said, go. But now he's arrived, and God said, now look. Look every direction, and I'm giving that to you. And I'm giving that to your seed. Now, by the way, Abraham never saw the fulfillment of that promise. So is he just like out of luck? In fact, Hebrews said he searched for a city whose builder and maker was God. But he didn't ever find it. But he's coming back, because we find the promises in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John that in the resurrection, those faithful in Israel are going to sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom. So they're going to see it. It's just been delayed. No problem with that. We're seated in the heavenly places, but it looks like we're seated here. See how that works? Okay, now, but anyway, let's go to the next passage, chapter 15. And verse 18. And in the same day, God made a covenant. We mentioned this before. Covenant, just a Bible word for contract. God says, Abraham, we're going to make a contract. Okay. I tell you what, if I was making a contract, there's no person I'd rather have a contract with than God. He's not going to try to stiff you. He's not going to try to take advantage of you. He's not going to try to get out of it. He's going to do exactly what he said he's going to do. He's going to make a pledge. And he says, the same day the Lord made a covenant with Abraham, saying, unto thy seed I give this land. Now remember, when he was back home, before he left, it was general. I'm going to give you a land. And then, a little later, he said, look. Look north, south, east, west, I'm going to give you a land. But now notice he's starting to give the borders of the land. Because he said, unto thy seed I give this land from the river of Egypt unto the great river, the river Euphrates. And then in the next three verses, it lists all the Gentile nations that currently occupy that land. He specifically listed them. And he said, I'm giving all that to you. That's going to be yours. Chapter 17. So notice how as time goes on, the promise gets clearer. Remember what Jesus Christ is doing? Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision to confirm the promises, to confirm the truth for the truth of God, to confirm the promises made to the fathers. Jesus Christ is not going against any of this. He's come to validate that. In fact, he's the answer to Israel's dominion. Of course, they don't have enough faith to believe it. They'd rather have the Romans rule them. Away with him. We don't want him. We will not have this man rule over us. The people of God can really be stupid. By the way, I didn't say Israel. I said the people of God. I include us too. Right? We can really be stupid. We do some stupid things in our lives that shows how much we need God. Okay. Anyway, chapter 17, verse 7. And I will establish my covenant between me and thee. And, maybe we'll get in here. Oops, no. And thy seed after thee, in their generations for an everlasting covenant, to be a God unto thee and to thy seed after thee. He's a God unto them. He's the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Verse 8, and I will give unto thee and to thy seed after thee the land wherein thou art a stranger, all the land of Canaan for everlasting possession, and I will be their God. Continue reading. Verse 9, and God said unto Abraham, thou shalt keep my covenant, therefore thou and thy seed after thee in their generations. And this is my covenant. So now we're expanding the covenant. Now we're going to have we're going to seal the covenant. You know, we sign documents, we press a notary stamp, we're documenting this. And here's the documentation. And the documentation is, drop your pants. This is crazy, isn't it? Does it ever? Of course, now we know he didn't have pants, he had to raise his, you know, but God said, show me your manhood, because we're going to do some cutting. What? Are you kidding me? Wow, this is a strange covenant here. Notice he says, and God said unto Abraham, verse 10, and this is my covenant you shall keep between me and you and your seed after thee. Every man child among you shall be circumcised. What do I do with that? I'll stick it in my pocket. I'm worried about this thing drying up here. I got to get the lead back on it. Circumcised. Verse 11. And you shall circumcise the flesh of your foreskin, and it shall be a token of the covenant betwixt me and you. The very token of God's covenant with Israel is circumcision. So every time when Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision, no wonder he's confirming the promises made to the fathers. Because that's the sign, that's the token, that's the evidence of the covenant made with Israel. Circumcision. Nobody's been circumcised before. The whole world's uncircumcised. We're going to circumcise these people. Verse 12. Very detailed. And he that is 8 days old shall be circumcised. 8 day, not 7, not 6, not 9, 8th day. Some of you men may say, well, I'm circumcised. Were you circumcised the eighth day? According to the promise made to Abraham, are you the seed of Abraham? If you're not the seed of Abraham, notice there's something else here, though. Notice what he says. And verse 12 again. And he that is 8 days old shall be circumcised among you, every child in your generations, he that is born in the house, or bought with money of any stranger which is not thy seed. So you didn't even have to be the seed of Abraham. You could be in a Jewish household and get circumcised and become a part of the family. I doubt that happened to any of us. If we got circumcised, we got circumcised for cultural reasons or something, if we got circumcised. But we weren't circumcised the eighth day in a Jewish house according to the covenant of Abraham. Verse 13, and he that is born in thy house and he that is bought with thy money must needs be circumcised, and my covenant shall be in your flesh for an everlasting covenant, and the uncircumcised man-child whose flesh of his foreskin is not circumcised, that soul shall be cut off from his people. He hath broken my covenant. So God draws a line between all the nations of the world and this special nation, and he draws a line, and that line's circumcision. And if you're circumcised the eighth day in accordance with the covenant of Abraham, you're on this side, and if not, you're on the wrong side of the tracks. And even though I had medical circumcision when I was born, it was not the eighth day according to the covenant of Abraham, nor was I in a Jewish household. And you know what? I was born on the wrong side of the track. All of us, we're on the wrong side of the tracks. It's okay, though. We find out God likes the wrong side of the track, don't we? We didn't get to that yet. Okay, well, let's keep going here. I'm dangerous as a marker now. I'm marking my hand up. Okay, so we see here. So God's covenant then is his first covenant with the Abrahamic covenant is a covenant that establishes the land. But notice what else it establishes. It establishes the people. It establishes the people two ways. Okay? By birth, that as they are seed, I'm making this covenant with you and your seed. And then anybody who becomes a part of your family, otherwise we would call these proselytes, then through circumcision, all of them are identified. So, you'd know if a man was on this side by circumcision. That gives you a lot of things to think about. How does anybody even know anybody's circumcised? Well, that's a whole nother story. Yeah. In fact, if you want an interesting story, study the word testament and to testify and see what in the world that had to do with. It gets translated for us, people are putting their hands on their thighs, but that's not exactly where their hands were. Anyway, we'll just say that. We live in a funny culture who can't take even the things of God. Okay, now, let's go to Exodus chapter 3. Exodus chapter 3. So there's the Abrahamic covenant. So what we have in the Abrahamic covenant, Exodus 3. So here's what we have in the Abrahamic covenant. We have the Israelites, we have the covenants, we have the service, because they're gonna help the Gentile nations, and we have the circumcision. Did I put that on there? Okay. Maybe it's actually on another list. So, all right, Exodus chapter 3, verse 6. Now, this is the Mosaic covenant. Sorry, I get close to that mic sometimes. Exodus chapter 3 and verse 6. Moreover, he said, I am the God of thy father, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob. And Moses hid his face, for he was afraid to look upon. This is serious, man. God approaches Moses and he says, I'm the covenant God of your fathers. Moses knew everything that meant. And notice in he repeats that, by the way, in verse 16. Go and gather the elders of Israel together and say unto them, the Lord God of your fathers, the God of Abraham, the God of Isaac and of Jacob, appointed me. So now Moses on the scene, and he's a spokesman for God. Go to Exodus chapter 19. This is where the covenant's established. Now, Exodus chapter 19, this is the covenant right here. Let's move this. This is the covenant of national law. You'll never understand the law of Moses if you don't understand it's a national law. It's a law for, it's a government. It's about a nation. It's about a country. You know, it's not for something for you to observe. Even if you could, you couldn't do it. You know, it's like throwing the U.S. Legal code in your lap and saying, do that all by yourself, you know. Well, you can't do it. It's a national law. And notice he says in chapter 19, beginning of verse 3, and Moses went up unto God, and the Lord called him out of the mountain, saying, thus shalt thou say to the house... To who? Who are they going to say this to? Who's Moses going to talk to? House of Jacob. Now, you know Jacob's name was changed to Israel. Yeah, and he even sort of... So he just repeats himself in the next line. And tell the children of Israel, the house of Jacob... The children of Israel. You and I are left out here. So this is for them. Verse 5. Now, therefore, if ye will obey my voice indeed and keep my covenant, then you shall be a peculiar treasure unto me above all people, for all the earth is mine. A peculiar people. Remember that. Peculiar people. Verse 6. And ye shall be unto me a kingdom of priests. The idea wasn't that Israel would just have some priests among them that would be priests to them. The whole nation was going to become a priest. Priest to who? They're going to be priests to the nations. A kingdom, kingdom, government of priests and a holy nation. By the way, that's the same people Peter spoke to. Peter was apostle of the circumcision. He was one of the 12. Peter says, you're a peculiar people. You're a... what does he say? Anyway, he repeats these things here. Lost the quotation out there for a second. He says, these are the words which thou shalt speak to the children of Israel. So now the law's been added. National law for Israel. Now I'm just going to throw one thing out at you about this law. He gives the law in chapter 20. Israel, you probably know the story. Moses comes down and says, hey, God wants to make a deal with you. And they said, well, you go back and tell God. Let's see. Well, right, verse 8. Look at 19:8. Here's the answer. So God says, go tell Israel I want to make a covenant with them. Moses goes over. He says, God wants to make a covenant with you. Listen what they said. Verse 8. And the people answered together and said, all that the Lord hath spoken, we will do. You see that word all? Are you kidding me? Hey, Moses didn't even tell them yet. Moses didn't even tell them yet what they were supposed to do. And they said, we'll do it all. God said, yeah, we're going to see if you can do it all. Are you kidding me? Let me ask you something. I told you earlier, God's people are really stupid sometimes. Well, maybe like most of the time. We're just, you know, well, we can't help it. God made us that way. We're the creatures, right? Let me ask you something. If I brought a contract in and I laid it before you and I said, I don't mean you go make a contract. Now listen, don't read any of this stuff here. Just sign right here. That's what Israel did. They signed a covenant, they don't even know what's in it. They said, but we'll do it all. Now, I'm going to tell you something about this whole thing is about teaching humanity something. In fact, go to chapter 20, and I want to show you one interesting verse about. So they get to Mount Sinai. And oh my goodness, the fire starts, and the smoke, and the thunder and lightning, and oh my goodness, it's terrifying. They're trembling. And they don't even want to talk to him. They just want to talk to Moses. We don't want to talk to him. And notice what Moses said, verse 20. And Moses said to the people, fear not, for God is come to prove you. Now, I didn't even check some of the other translations. I'm just reading out of King James right now. But that Hebrew word is the word for test. Did you know that the whole covenant of the law at Sinai was a test? He was testing them. And they signed it without reading it. I'm going to tell you what I believe that the response of faith should have been. Faith. Someone tell me what Abraham or Isaac or Jacob's responsibility was in the covenant. In those covenants, it's only God doing everything. I'll do this, I'll do this, I'll do this, I'll do this. That's a good covenant. That's awesome. Now all of a sudden God says, now we're going to want you to do some stuff, so you'll be my people. You know what the response of faith could have been and maybe should have been? Moses comes and says, now God said he's going to give us a list of things to do and then we'll be a special people to him. You know what faith would say? You go back and tell God we're not interested in this contract because we're already a special people based on the promise made to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. So we're not getting anything out of this deal. You already gave us this stuff. It was a test. But instead of knowing that who God was, they thought they were somebody. Oh, yeah. Isn't that what people always want to know? What they can do for God. Yeah, we can do it. Just lay it out there. You know? And some people think it was just 10 commandments. There was 619 of them boogers. Yeah? Woo! And them some humdingers in there too. You know, we can't even get past the 10. We've got those, we've got a lot of them done, but oh my goodness. But that's the Mosaic Covenant. Look in Deuteronomy chapter 11. We got to move faster. Deuteronomy chapter 11. We'll try to read more and talk less. Deuteronomy 11, verse 21. That your days may be multiplied and the days of your children in the land which God sware unto your fathers to give them. And I want you to notice this next phrase. Here was God's plan for Israel. As the days of heaven upon the earth. That was God's plan for Israel. Have you ever heard people say, let's move some of this here. Heaven on earth. This was God's plan. Israel ever have anything even look like heaven on earth? They never did. They were always in and out of captivity, in and out of famine, in and out of trouble. But God's plan was it to be heaven on earth, as the days of heaven on the earth. Now that's going to come into play when we read more verses. Okay, go to chapter 14, verse 2. And here he just repeats that same thing, for thou art, 14:2, for thou art a holy people unto the Lord thy God, and God hath chosen you to be a peculiar people unto himself above all the nations that are upon the earth. Go to chapter 28, though. And now let's look at the reality of how the law works. Now, I don't know where all of you stand on the law, but let me tell you, the law was a raw deal. And if you want to be a part of the law, well, maybe I'm not going to say you're as stupid as Israel, but I guess I just did. You know, it's amazing how much of Christianity wants to be under the law. Are you kidding me? Do you not know how the law operates? It operates by a principle that we would call if, then. That is because all the other covenants that God had made was all up to God. But now, man has a part. And the thing is, if you will do this, Israel, then God says it, then I will do some stuff. Well, let's see what kind of stuff he'll do. Deuteronomy chapter 28. Now here's the verse. If there's anybody here who has any inkling that they might like the law, let's read Deuteronomy 28, verse 1. And it shall come to pass if. Oh, that's a big word. If. Oh, this might go either way. If thou shalt hearken diligently to the voice of the Lord thy God and observe and do, how many? You know what Jesus said, right? If you offend one point of the law, you did what? If you default on an agreement on one point, that agreement's been defaulted on. All. Uh-oh. And we didn't even find out what it was we were agreeing to. Which I command thee this day, that the Lord thy God shall set thee on high above all nations of the earth. And all these blessings shall come upon thee and overtake thee if thou shalt hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God. Now I want you to notice, verse 3 starts with blessed. Verse 4 starts with blessed. Verse 5 starts with blessed. Verse 6 starts with blessed. Verse 7 says, and the Lord shall cause. Verse 8, and the Lord shall. Verse 9, and the Lord shall. And if you read through these, let me tell you what, heaven on earth is right there. Because go back, we'll start at verse 2, verse 3. Blessed shalt thou be in the city, and blessed shalt thou be in the field. Hey, doesn't that cover it all? I'm in the city, I'm in the country, I'm blessed. Yeah, woohoo! Okay, verse 4. And blessed shall be the fruit of thy body, and the fruit of the ground, and the fruit of the cattle, and the increase of thy kine, and the flocks of thy sheep. Man, be fruitful, multiply. I'm into this. This is getting good. Yeah. Verse 5. And blessed shall be thy basket and thy store, and blessed shalt thou be when thou comest in, and blessed shalt thou be when thou goest out. I mean, this is... we got it covered. You're either coming in or going out, and you're getting blessed both ways. You're either in the city or in the country. You're blessed both ways. Man. And all I have to do is everything. That's all I got to do. All of it. Oh, man. And it's going to be heaven on earth. This is good, isn't it? Say, sign me up. I want to be in the law. Well, let's look at verse 15. But. Oh. You know, when things are going good and a but comes along, you know it's going to turn around the other way. But it shall come to pass that if thou wilt not hearken to the voice of the Lord thy God to do all. So now you miss one. All his commandments and his statutes which I command thee this day, that all these curses shall come upon thee and overtake thee. And just like in the first part of the chapter, look at 16, starts with curse. 17, curse it. 18, curse it. 19, curse it. He goes back and he retraces all those places he's been. Now you're going to be cursed in the city, and you're going to be cursed out in the country, and you're going to be cursed going in, you're going to be cursed going out. And verse 20 and 21 and 22 and 23 and 24 and 25 and all says, and the Lord's going to do this to you. Hey, wait a minute. Can we annul this agreement? Wow. That's the nature of the covenant of the Mosaic Law. Joshua chapter 3, verse 13. Do you know what Paul says when he wrote to the Galatians about the law? He says that Moses ministered the covenant of the law. And you know what he calls it? That it was a covenant of condemnation and death. Paul said that. Moses was the dispenser of the covenant, the dispensation of law, and it was a dispensation of condemnation and death. And can you believe that thousands of years later, Christianity, who's supposed to know something about Calvary and supposed to know something about the Apostle Paul, would dare to put themselves right back under condemnation and death? Davidic covenant, real quick, 2 Samuel. We're trying to go in the order of the scripture so easy to follow. 2 Samuel 7. Now, we still have one more covenant, and that's the covenant of David. Which, by the way, leaves one thing, and that is we have people, we have land, we got law. We got one more thing we need. We need some government. I mean, government. David's going to get the government. All right. 2 Samuel 7 and verse 10. Moreover, I will appoint a place for my people Israel. That's the land. Got that. Verse 12. And when the days be fulfilled, and thou shalt sleep with thy fathers, I will set up thy seed after thee, which shall proceed out of thy bowels, and I will establish his kingdom. That's what you need. Government. Kingdom. Who is it going to be? David's seed. We're going to make a kingdom out of David's seed. Verse 13. And he shall build a house for my name. So this is going to be a religious nation. It's going to have a house of worship. And I will establish my throne. Throne. Government. Of his kingdom forever. And I will be his father, and he shall be my son. And if he commit iniquity, I will chasten him with the rod of men and with the stripes of the children of men. But my mercy shall not depart from him, as I took it from Saul, whom I put away before thee. And his house and thine house and thy kingdom shall be established forever before thee. Thy throne shall be established forever. So what God establishes with David is a kingdom, a throne, and a house. The temple, place of worship. All this under the Davidic covenant. In your notes, I listed a ton of verses that you can look up. Can I just briefly tell you, for time's sake, what the promise is? Well, I'll tell you what. Let's just say this. Israel was a complete failure at this. Right here, they didn't do it. So Israel never became heaven on earth, and they never blessed any Gentiles. In fact, they were haughty against the Gentiles. We are God's people. You want to see? I'll show you my circumcision. You know, they became haughty against the Gentiles. In fact, Paul says that the Jews, that the circumcision and uncircumcision called each other names. They called each other circumcision and uncircumcision. Called each other racial and religious names. It was ugly. But you know what? Forget Sinai. God made an earlier covenant with Abraham that had no conditions. And that covenant's going to be fulfilled. Go to Jeremiah chapter 33, the new covenant. Now, listen, I know this cuts deep to some of us, maybe. Jeremiah chapter 31. Jeremiah 31. By the way, Hebrews chapter 8 says that the reason we call the Mosaic covenant the Old Covenant is because God will establish in the future a new covenant with Israel, which will make the Mosaic covenant old. It'll make it pass away old. And just as surely, Jeremiah chapter 31. And just as surely as the old covenant, and it'll be okay when I tell you this. But as surely as the old covenant was with the house of Israel, so the new covenant's with the house of Israel. It's a covenant God made with them. It's funny, people come to the Greek books of the Bible, Matthew through Revelation, and it says on the front that it's the New Testament. Well, somebody just made that up and wrote that there. Because Jesus didn't even die to the end of the Gospels, which is the very basis of a new covenant. But let's read carefully. Let's just be honest and literal. Let's be honest with ourselves. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 31. It's easy to remember, by the way, if you want to remember. Jeremiah 31, 31. Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant. Oh, now it's time for us, right? We're getting in on this deal. With who? With the house of Israel and the house of Jacob. not according to the covenant I made with their fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. Which covenant, my covenant, they break. Although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After these days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. But that's not you and me. That's Israel. God's going to fix Israel one day. Ah. That's good. Now, I'm not clapping and thankful just because of Israel. I'm clapping and thankful because God's reputation's at stake. He made promises. And listen, we didn't come in and steal their promises. We didn't come in here and say, God said, well, I'm done with them crooks. I'm done with them lousy, good for nothings. I'm going to give you everything. I'm going to give you their stuff. That would be dishonest. God's faithful. Oh, a number of times in the Old Testament it says he's faithful to perform his promises to 1,000 generations. God's not done. This is for the house of Israel. This is for the house of Jacob. And by the way, verse 34, and they shall teach no more every man his neighbor. Did you see that, by the way? If you were under the if we were under the new covenant, you wouldn't be here because I'm teaching you. On the new covenant, you don't need to be taught. Because why? God's writing it all in their hearts. Do you understand what's happening? He's going to take away their stony hearts. He's going to take away all the things that wouldn't allow them to do what God wanted. And he's going to put his spirit in them. And he's going to put the law in them. And it won't even need to be taught. The very fact you need to be taught is very evident that you're not under this covenant. The very truth of the matter. Well, I'm figuring out which parts not to tell you about. But listen, the verses are in your notes. And now, in these latter epistles, the latter prophets and the minor prophets that are in the Old Testament, God begins to detail how he's going to take this new covenant and restore Israel. And he's going to restore them, and this phrase gets repeated, as the days of heaven on earth. And he says, and the blind are going to see, and the deaf are going to hear when I get this covenant going, and the lame are going to walk. And all those things that I said that I would do if you did it, I'm just going to do them anyway. It's very detailed. Again, they're in your notes, so you can read them at home. I was hoping we would read them together, but our day's just getting away with us. I will read one verse, though, before we move to the Gospels. Daniel, a few books over, Daniel chapter 2. If these thoughts and studies mean anything to you, I encourage you to read all the verses that I gave you in the notes, because only then will some of the things in the Gospels make sense, because Jesus Christ is confirming all that stuff that was said. And if you go in detail, he said, I'm going to bless you, and I'm going to heal your sick, and the blind are going to see, and the deaf are going to hear, and the lame are going to walk, and Jesus Christ shows up, and guess what's happening? All that stuff's happening. Because according to Hebrews, they were tasting the good world to come. It was only temporary, but they were getting a taste. It's like, you know, a sample. Like when you go to the store and, you know, and they got a little thing set up and you can have a little sample. So, that's good. He was trying to... And even after all the sampling, people are raised from the dead in Jesus' ministry. You know what he's doing? He's confirming the promises made to the fathers. The lame are walking. He's confirming the promises made to the fathers. The blind are seeing. He's confirming the promises made to the fathers. The woman with the issue of blood, he's confirming the promises made to the fathers. And then you know what they do? We will not have this man reign over us. What? Are you kidding me? Again, human history is to show the utter failure of man without God. Even when the Son of God's present, they can't get it. Daniel chapter 2 and verse 44. And in the days of these kings shall the God of heaven set up a kingdom which shall never be destroyed. God's going to set up a kingdom. By the way, I left an important part out of that. I went to write it and I realized I didn't even read it. And in the days of these kings shall the God, or maybe I did read it, the God of what?
Heaven.
Hey, I heard of that place. But notice it's just God of heaven. And he's going to establish a kingdom. And it's going to be like heaven on earth. Now, if you establish, if God established a kingdom from heaven on earth, and it would be like king, like heaven on earth, you probably could call that kingdom the kingdom of heaven. And that's exactly what Israel's kingdom's called in the Gospels. Not because it's a kingdom that's in heaven, but that it's a kingdom from heaven that Israel's is receiving. Now, let's read a few quick verses in Matthew. Listen, I just got more material than I thought I was going to be able to cover. We're just going to sort of run these. I know it's, if you need to go to the bathroom, do so. If you need something to eat, need to stretch. I'm going to just sort of run these next two sessions right in, and then we can finish with some question and answers. But Matthew chapter 1. Now, this is our backdrop. This lesson today, this session right here that we're dealing with, is Israel's covenants. And Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision. He was ministering to the seed of Abraham, and he's confirming the promises. So now let's watch. Matthew chapter 1, verse 1. The book, here's the first thing we read after we flip the page from Malachi. Genesis 1:1. Matthew 1:1. Just like Genesis 1:1 tells you a whole lot. Heaven and earth. Well, Matthew 1:1 tells you a lot. The book of the generations of Jesus Christ, the son of David, the son of Abraham. You know what the right Matthew does? He takes the first and primary covenant, Abraham, and he takes the Davidic covenant, which, by the way, involves the people, the land, help me out here, what law and government is all wrapped up in these two men. And the very first things, in fact, the very first thing he didn't even tell you he's the Son of God. The very first thing you learn about Jesus is he's David's son. Wait a minute, David's son sits on the throne. He's Abraham's son. Wait a minute. These are the covenants. Wow. You see, that's sort of meaningless to us. We say, oh, yeah, whatever. That's because we're Gentiles, you know? Look at chapter 2, verse 2. Now, we'll just try to read really quickly. And here's the wise men, 2:2, saying, where is he that is born? King of the Jews. Jesus Christ came to confirm the promises made to the fathers. Isn't it about a kingdom? Isn't it about a king? Isn't it about a nation? Isn't it about a land? He's the king of the Jews. Hey, nothing different going on. Look in verse 5. No, verse 6. And behold, thou Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least of these provinces of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor, ruler, government. God's plan's not over. That shall rule who? My people, Israel. Let me tell you what. Jesus came. Listen, Romans chapter 9, we read it earlier. As who concerning the flesh, Christ came. He didn't come for me. Now he did. But it was a secret. God didn't tell anybody yet. He came for Israel. He came to rule over them. He came to save His people from their sins. Go to chapter 4, verse 17. Remember what we learned in Romans chapter 15, verse 8? Now I say that Jesus Christ was a minister of the circumcision for the truth of God to confirm the promises. Confirm the promises made to fathers. I'm going to confirm all those promises. 14, 17. From that time, Jesus began to what? Preach. What did Paul say? He was a minister. Well, here he is. He's a minister. He's up giving his message. And what does he say? And he says, repent. For what reason? The kingdom, remember that right here? That's the days of earth as heaven on earth. And that's what he's preaching. He's confirming the promises made to the fathers. Verse 23. And Jesus went all about Galilee, teaching in their synagogues and preaching the gospel of the kingdom. See that word gospel? We know what it means, right? Good news. Did you know there's a lot of good news in the Bible? There's the everlasting gospel. There's the gospel of the kingdom. There's the gospel of the grace of God. Good news is just good news. You know what this gospel is? It's the gospel of the kingdom. And then what did you do? Healing all manner. See right there? Exactly what that message was about. Wow. Okay. Chapter 5, verse 3. Well, you know what? Let's move on, because that tied into something else that we should have looked at earlier. Let's just remind you of the Lord's Prayer. The Lord's Prayer is, Thy kingdom come. Ain't nobody saying, let's go there. No, no, let's let heaven come here as the days of heaven on the earth, as the prophet said. That's all well and good. Except I'm going to the root of the matter. I'm going to the source. But anyway, that's another story altogether. We got to keep going. This is how I get in trouble. All right, chapter 8. Chapter 8. Let's read it. And I say unto you that many shall come from the east. Now he's talking about when Israel gets restored, that many are going to come from the east and from the west and sit down with Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob in the kingdom of heaven, right here on earth. Wow. See, Jesus Christ, this is just the same thing. Go to chapter, chapter 9. No. Let's go to chapter 10. Yeah, this is where as they'd say, the rubber meets the road. Chapter 10. Now, you'll probably recognize Matthew chapter 10, because this is where the 12 apostles get selected. Woohoo! 12 apostles. Remember we learned earlier? They're the apostles of Israel. They're going to sit on the 12 thrones of Israel, judging the 12 tribes of Israel. You know, we're flat out of luck with these guys. And look and read and see how out of luck we are. Matthew 10:5. These 12 Jesus sent forth and commanded them, saying, go. Now give me the next word. Go not into the way of the Gentiles. Jesus sent out his disciples and told them, and he says, you know what? Not to come to us. What? Are you kidding me? These are our ancestors here. We go to ancestry.com. Our ancestors. Jesus told his disciples not to go to them. He even told them not to go to the half-breeds. And into any city of the Samaritans enter ye not, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel, and go preach, saying, the kingdom of heaven's at hand. Kingdom of heaven's nearby. It's almost in reach. But we will not have this man rule over us. Wow. And then what did they do? They healed, verse 8, they healed the sick, they cleansed the lepers, they raised the dead. They did all the things that the promises made to the fathers were. Wow. Go to chapter 15. Here's another shocker. Shock, 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 shock. If you don't know right division, if you don't rightly divide the word of truth, if you don't know 2 Timothy 2:15, then this passage I'm getting to read to you is an ugly passage of Scripture. It's shameful and disgraceful. I can't stress it enough. We're going to read it. You probably, chances are, growing up in Sunday school, you never even heard this passage. It's that shameful. Matthew chapter 15 and verse 21. And Jesus went thence and departed into the coast of Tyre and Sidon. And a woman, a Canaan, came out of the same coast. So here comes a Canaanite woman. This woman's not a Jew. Okay? And cried unto him, saying, Have mercy on me, O Lord, thou son of David. My daughter is grievously vexed with the devil. And he answered her not a word. He just ignored her. Wow. That don't even sound like Jesus, does it? Wait a minute. Romans 15:8 says Jesus Christ was the minister of the circumcision. She was uncircumcision. And his disciples came and besought him. Now, here's what you expect disciples to say, right? Hey, Jesus, what's the deal here? You're ignoring this woman. This is rude. Do they say that? Look what the disciples say. Send her away. This woman is crying after us. Send her away. What's the problem? She's the wrong race. She's the wrong seed. She's the wrong covenant. Remember this line we put right here? She's on the wrong side of the tracks. And Jesus ignores her. And the disciples ignore her. Now notice what happens here. But he answered and said, I am not sent but unto the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Jesus Christ, a minister of circumcision, to confirm the promises made unto the fathers. If we don't get this down, we will misunderstand the Gospels. But you remember, and I wish I had time to have read some of those other verses, but they're all in your notes. But remember what Israel was supposed to do? Israel was supposed to be heaven on earth and then bless out to the Gentiles. But instead, they were a failure. And they became prideful and arrogant. And now Jesus' response here is touching this nerve. And notice what the woman says. And then verse 25. Then came she in worship, saying, Lord, help me. And he answered and said, Is it not meet to take children's bread, that's Israel's blessings, and to cast them to dogs? You know what I'm doing? Jesus said, you know what I'm doing? I'm laying the banquet table for the children. But you're a dog. Let me tell you something. If you think you want to go back under the Old Testament and live, and if you think you want to live under the law, then here's what. If you get a blessing, you've got to wait till Israel gets right and is like the kingdom, is like heaven on earth, and then you'll get a blessing. Otherwise, you're just an outcast. You're a dog on the outside of the house. You don't even get to come to the table. But listen to her response. And she said, what the heck? You know what she says? Truth. See, you know what we like to do? We like to take the things we know that we learned from Paul, and then we read all the way back and we think everybody always knew these things. You know what? This woman was coming to Israel's Messiah because she knew who he was. She knew he was the answer. And he said, listen, I'm here to feed the children, and you don't qualify. And she said, yes, you're telling the truth. No squabble from me. But hey, Lord, here's a thought. Even the dogs get to eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. And Jesus answered and said unto her, O woman, great is thy faith, be it unto thee as thou wilt. And her daughter was made whole that very hour. You know how she got a blessing? She came through Israel. Isaiah says that Israel, God's plan is that Israel will rise to the head nation as the glory of God, and all the Gentiles will come to Israel's light. That's the plan on the earth. And this is a little sampling of it out of course, a little sampling ahead of time, like that little sample you get of what might be to come. Now, once again, tons of verses here that we just can't get to. For instance, John 4:22, it says there, for salvation is of the Jews. If you're going to get saved, if you're going to get a blessing from God, you've got to come through Israel. That's the plan. Some people might say, okay, so when does this all change? Well, I'll just tell you this. Acts chapter 2. Let's go to Acts chapter 2. I'll show you a couple things. I'll tell you when it changes. When it changes is when that God stops a man on his tracks, and his name is Saul of Tarsus, and he's breathing out threatenings against God's work, and he's fighting against God, and Jesus Christ stops him right in his tracks. And I'll show you a couple verses in a minute. And if you'll bear with me, we'll get there. And God takes this man, he changes his name to Paul, and he makes him the apostle to the nations. And he reveals a secret. And God's in essence saying this. I'm just going to paraphrase it for you for a minute. And in essence, God says this. You know all that stuff back there? I've been hiding something from you. I've hid something. I've been keeping something a secret. And he opens up the doors of heaven. And he opens up the doors of grace. Look in Acts chapter 2. Paul's not even converted yet. Acts chapter 2, Pentecost. We can do these some other time, tie these all in. You read those notes, you got questions, just ask. Acts chapter 2, verse 1, and when the day of Pentecost was fully come, verse 14, and Peter, standing up with the 11, Peter stands up. Here's what he says. We're going to have to trust that he knows what he's talking about. By the way, chapter 1, we can't go so fast we miss some keys. Acts chapter 1, verse 6, Jesus is raised from the dead and he meets with the disciples. And here's the question. And when therefore they came together, they ask him, the disciples saying, Lord, will thou at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? Best question in the world. Resurrection of Jesus Christ. Are you going to restore the kingdom now? Chapter 2, verse 14. But Peter, standing up with the 11, lifted up his voice and said unto them, ye men of Judea. Verse 16, what's happening at Pentecost? This is that which was spoken by the prophet Joel. It's the promises made to the fathers. And then he says, your sons, your daughters, Israel, your old men, Israel. Verse 22, ye men of Israel. Verse 36, let therefore all the house of Israel know, assuredly. We didn't even get in yet. Chapter 3, verse 13, the God of Abraham, of Isaac, and of Jacob. Let's go to chapter 11 and read one more historical context, and then I'm going to close. Acts chapter 11, verse 19. Now they which were scattered abroad upon the persecution, this is Acts 11, 19. Persecution that arose about Stephen traveled so far as Phoenicia and Cyprus and Antioch, preaching the word to none but the Jews only. We're even in Acts chapter 11. There finally makes a shift with the ministry of Paul, and then it becomes to the Jew first, but the Jew still has priority. They're still first.